and welcome to XPlore, where we discuss educational theories, concepts, models, and other topics of interest. I'm Dr. Colin A. Harris. Thank you for joining us. Today we will discuss false consciousness and how hegemony works to produce false consciousness in society. But before we continue, there are two terms we must first define in order to eliminate confusion. That is false consciousness and hegemony. Hegemony is when the dominant group uses its power, influence, and ideas to control another. It is the dominant ideology of beliefs in a society that defines what is right, natural, ideal, or avoidable. Hegemony is the way power operates on a cultural level. It refers to how one group dominates and controls another. This phenomenon is possible when the oppressed classes work against their own self-interest. False consciousness is a term used to define how individuals or a group willfully participate in their own oppression. False consciousness is a state of self-identity that prevents a person from recognizing social injustice or inequality. The concept refers to the systemic misrepresentation of dominant social relations in the consciousness of subordinate classes. So, what is the relationship between cultural hegemony and false consciousness? Cultural hegemony is a systemic apparatus that works to produce an artificially induced state of false consciousness in the minds of the population, either through coercion, manufactured consent, or willful consent. Specifically, the ruling class convinces the working class that it is in the working class' best interests to maintain and protect the current systems and structures, with the promise that they too can benefit from said systems and structures.
There are, of course, those who do not want us to speak.
Let me think.
Even now, orders are being shouted into telephones, and men with guns will soon be on their way.
It's Chancellor Sutler.
Damn it!
Why? Because while the truncheon may be used in lieu of conversation, words will always retain their power. Words are for the means to meaning, and for those who will listen, the enunciation of truth. And the truth is, there is something terribly wrong with this country, isn't there?
You designed it, sir. You wanted it foolproof. You told me every television in London.
Cruelty and injustice, intolerance and oppression. And where once you had the freedom to object, to think and speak as you saw fit, you now have sensors and systems of surveillance coercing your conformity and soliciting your submission.
We need cameras.
How did this happen? Who's to blame? Well, certainly there are those who are more responsible than others, and they will be held accountable. But again, truth be told, if you're looking for the guilty, you need only look into a mirror. I know why you did it. I know you were afraid. Who wouldn't be? War, terror, disease. There were a myriad of problems which conspired to corrupt your reason and rob you of your common sense. Fear got the best of you, and in your panic you turned to the now High Chancellor, Adam Sutler. He promised you order, he promised you peace, and all he demanded in return was your silent, obedient consent.
Once the ruling class, i.e. hegemonic class, receives consent from the working class or oppressed class, the ruling class must work continuously to maintain that consent. The ruling class relies on domination, influence, and authority to garnish consent in order to maintain power and control, hoard money, increase productivity, and strengthen military might. False consciousness is a theory rooted in orthodox Marxist belief, surrounding the relationship between an individual, society, and power. Marx stated, "It is not the consciousness of man that determines their being, but on the contrary, their social being that determines their consciousness."
For the League's purposes, there are two kinds of men. Men have been hardened and forged by men who labor, and men who profit from the fruits of that labor, the bourgeoisie.
So tell me, Gordon, when does it all end, huh? How many yachts can you water ski behind? How much is enough?
It's not a question of enough, pal. It's a zero-sum game. Somebody wins, somebody loses. Money itself isn't lost or made. It's simply transferred from one perception to another. Like magic. This painting here, I
bought it 10 years ago for $60,000. I could sell it today for $600. The illusion has become real. And the more real it becomes, the more desperate they want it. Capitalism at its finest.
How much is enough for them?
The richest 1% of this country owns half our country's wealth, $5 trillion. One-third of that comes from hard work. Two-thirds comes from an inheritance, interest on interest accumulating to widows and idiot sons. And what I do, stock and real estate speculation. It's bullshit. You got 90% of the American public out there with little or no net worth. I create nothing. I own. We make the rules, pal. The news, war, peace, famine, upheaval, the price of a paperclip. We pick that rabbit out of the hat while everybody sits out there wondering how the hell we did it. Now, you're not naive enough to think we're living in a democracy, are you, buddy?
According to Marx, society maintains its social order by instilling a particular set of ideas and values in its members. For example, some religious ideologies and values reflect the beliefs and practices to which religious followers must adhere. Most of these values originated from the sacred texts of each religion and their respective leaders. Regardless of your religious beliefs, the fundamental purpose of religion is to control the population and garner compliance through the promise of eternal life, salvation, forgiveness, etc., providing you follow the teachings and rules of your religion.
It's not the case simply that Christ is God or God Christ.
You could say that again. The Nazarene was not God.
He was not God.
He was a man, part God.
No, sir. Rabbi, all of us have a little bit of God in us, don't we?
Well, it's the foundation of our belief that Christ is most properly referred to as the Son of God. It's the Son of God who takes the sins of the world upon himself so that the rest of God's children, we imperfect beings, through faith, may enter the kingdom of heaven.
However, these assurances come at a financial cost to religious followers in the form of tithings, collections, donations, and more.
Ain't that the truth?
God expects you to do what the Lord wants you to do. Like those of you who realize that the Lord wants you to give generously into his church.
Amen.
Don't ask no questions. Don't ask how come why come the pastor have to have him a nice house? Why come a pastor got to have a nice car? Don't ask. Don't ask no questions. Just give the money.
Amen. I got it right here.
Brother Dickie, get the collection plate around on that side. Nigga, get it around on that side.
Monetary contributions to religious institutions is a form of wealth distribution from the working class to the ruling class, either direct or indirect. This is evident in the financial standing of some of the world's largest churches. For example, the Catholic Church has an estimated global wealth of $75.9 billion. The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints has an estimated net worth of $67 billion. The Church of England is said to have an estimated net worth of $7.8 billion. The Church of Scientology is worth approximately $2.5 billion as of March of 2022. Lastly, the Episcopalian Church is estimated to be worth $2 billion. However, some believe that the organization is worth way more than its reported value and is possibly the largest church globally. Nonetheless, if we were to calculate the total worth of these five institutions, we would get an estimated net worth of $155.2 billion. It is essential to highlight that even though these religious institutions have attained significant wealth, more than half a billion people still live in extreme poverty globally. According to the World Bank, about 9.2% of the world's population, or 689 million people, live in extreme poverty today. New evidence compiled by the U.S. Census Bureau shows that the official U.S. poverty rate in 2020 was 11.4%, up 1 percentage point from 2019. In 2020, there were 37.2 million people in poverty, approximately 3.3 million more than in 2019. Legal values and principles. Laws, policies, and regulations are created to maintain social order so that the working class conform to the social standards placed by the elite class. In many civilizations today, these laws often subjugate society's poorest and often work in favor of the wealthy.
If we're just going to accept the system that treats you better if you're rich and guilty than if you're poor and innocent, then we can't claim to be just.
Educational values. Educational values are in place to shape the minds of society's children by teaching them what is expected, as prescribed by the ruling class. The ruling class indoctrinates students by teaching them the beliefs they deem necessary to push their agenda and to ensure that the status quo is maintained. Once the ruling class determines what children need to learn or not learn, they will work diligently to ensure every child complies.
Pathetic. This is why the Japs are overtaking us. And believe me, I don't mean you.
But we're working really hard.
You're not working hard enough. I need results. Class dismissed.
Socio-political values. Socio-political values are central to the identity and personality of the working class. By understanding the social and political values and the economic factors affecting the working class, the ruling class is able to capitalize on their conflicting ideologies by sowing division between the members of the oppressed class. Politicians consistently promote values, non-values, and anti-values to generate anger and resentment amongst the oppressed class.
To a leprechaun, okay?
Right.
May I read from page 7? Please come with me to Rainbow Land, where unicorns are made of fudge and cotton candy, and everything is free.
It's a fictitious place. Rainbow Land is, it's fiction.
I guess we're all idiots, according to Cam Brady.
I didn't say that. I did not say that.
Hey, I do not want to live in Rainbow Land, and you can't make me live in Rainbow Land. This is America.
You do not have to live in Rainbow Land.
You can go to Rainbow Land.
It does not exist. It's a fictitious place. I was 8 when I wrote it.
It's right here in his Communist Manifesto.
I won't go to Rainbow Land.
Sit down. I said, sit the fuck down. It doesn't exist.
Go back to where you're from, dick.
It's not a real place. How many times I gotta say it?
While the population is distracted by fighting over cultural issues such as abortion and reproductive rights, same-sex marriage, transgender rights, comprehensive sex education, critical race theory, etc., politicians are busy avoiding all efforts to pass legislations that would financially benefit the working class. However, they will go to extreme lengths to write laws that will funnel money to the ultra-wealthy and corporations, who will in turn funnel the money back to the politicians through legalized bribery.
Why have you consistently voted against campaign finance reform? We all know big money is running this country. Do they run you?
Hold on. Why don't we stop all the softball questions and ask some real questions, okay? Like, why won't Marty Huggins here take a lie detector test? Is he an Al-Qaeda? Is he a Taliban?
Congressman, please.
I've seen a mustache like that before, and you know who wore it? Saddam Hussein.
We are acquiring massive parcels of real estate under a shell corporation so we can reopen 3 large factories. Ostensibly, we own this district.
We think we can operate at the same regulatory and wage levels as China and eliminate shipping costs.
And your government will cooperate?
We also own the most important resource of all. A willing candidate.
Candidate? Your elections are unpredictable.
Mr. Zhang, there's something you need to know about American politics. When you've got the money, nothing is unpredictable.
Italian author Antonio Gramsci built upon Marxist theory. He is known today for the contemporary use of the term cultural hegemony. Gramsci was the founder and leader of Italy's Communist Party. He was incarcerated by the Italian government for his opposition to Benito Mussolini.
Gramsci Antonio,
Prenda il materasso e raduni la roba, c'è il trasferimento.
While in prison, Gramsci wrote his theory in a series of notebooks. According to scholars and historians, Gramsci's work consisted of about 30 notebooks and approximately 3,000 pages of written analysis. On April 27, 1937, Gramsci died while imprisoned by the fascist Italian regime. Gramsci was primarily concerned with the struggles of the working class against the ruling class. Gramsci believed that the dominant group exercises hegemony within society, which is intellectual domination over the subordinate group for consensual control. Domination is exercised through municipal, state, or federal governments, judicial systems, or coercive control.
Tonight, I will speak directly to these people and make the situation perfectly clear to them. The security of this nation depends on complete and total compliance. Tonight, any protester, any instigator, or agitator will be made example of.
Most modern political systems consist of at least two strong political parties with deep social roots, a judicial system marked by an unequal distribution of resources, and a police force increasingly backed by military influence.
And who are these guys? Heavily armed men in black with no law enforcement insignia standing guard outside the White House, some reportedly refusing to identify themselves. Turns out they're from a variety of federal agencies, including the FBI and the Bureau of Prisons, and they're under the direct supervision of Attorney General Bill Barr. They've been dubbed Bill Barr's private army.
The Department of Justice is working to restore order in the District of Columbia.
Culture frames an individual's identity and keep various groups in their respective position in the hierarchy of society.
Position. Would you wear a shoe on your head? Of course you wouldn't wear a shoe on your head. A shoe doesn't belong on your head. A shoe belongs on your foot. A hat belongs on your head. I am a hat. You are a shoe. I belong on the head. You belong on the foot. Yes? So it is. In the beginning, order was prescribed by your ticket. First class, economy, and freeloaders like you. Eternal order is prescribed by the sacred engine. All things flow from the sacred engine. All things in their place. All passengers in their section. All water flowing. All heat rising pays homage to the sacred engine in its own particular preordained position. So it is. Now, as in the beginning, I belong to the front. You belong to the tail. When the foot seeks the place of the head, sacred line is crossed. Know your place. Keep your place. Be a shoe.
I look down on him because I am upper class.
I look up to him because he is upper class. But I look down on him because he is lower class. I am middle class. I know my place.
Certain agreed upon ideas and values can be seen as a mechanism by the ruling class to continue its domination of the oppressed classes. Meaning, the mass majority working to benefit the small minority.
Our projections show that by the year 2025, not only America, but the entire planet will be under the protection and the dominion of this power alliance. The gains have been substantial, both for ourselves and for you, the human power elite.
The politics, art, religion, philosophy, and economy of the dominant classes are all based on the general premise to justify the inequality to maintain power.
Politicians have traditionally hidden behind three things: the flag, the Bible.
I brought my Bible.
And children. There's a reason education sucks, and it's the same reason that it will never, ever, ever be fixed. because the owners of this country don't want that. The big wealthy business interests that control things and make all the important decisions. Forget the politicians. The politicians are put there to give you the idea that you have freedom of choice. You don't. You have no choice. You have owners. They own you.
I own you. You're my bitch. So don't walk around here thinking you have free will, because you don't. I can crush you anytime I want. So settle in, because you are here for the long haul.
They own everything. They own all the important land. They own and control the corporations. They've long since bought and paid for the Senate, the Congress, the state houses, the city halls. They got the judges in their back pockets. And they own all the big media companies, so they control just about all of the news and information you get to hear. They got you by the balls.
Television remains the main source of news for many Americans. In 2016, 46% of adults said they got their news from local TV stations. And it's information they trust. 41% of registered voters said they trust local news to tell the truth, while just 27% trust national news. This weekend, the online site Deadspin created this compilation of dozens of Sinclair's local newscasters recording an identical promo accusing the national media of spreading fake news.
This is extremely dangerous to our democracy.
The video spread quickly on social media, again stirring criticism of the broadcast giant.
You know what they want? They want obedient workers. People who are just smart enough to run the machines and do the paperwork, and just dumb enough to passively accept all these increasingly shittier jobs with the lower pay, the longer hours, the reduced benefits, the end of overtime, and the vanishing pension that disappears the minute you go to collect it. And now they're coming for your Social Security money.
Ultimately, people are taught to value things that are actually bad for them. The theory also explains that controlling people's beliefs and ideas is the key to obtaining and maintaining power. The constructs of false consciousness are hegemony, subalternity, power, and control.
Hegemony. Hegemony is the domination or influence of one group, entity, or set of ideas over another.
Hegemony is rooted in self-interest and the pursuit of the hegemonic goal of maintaining a subordinate state.
Prepare to pay the ultimate price.
One of the most common tactics used by the ruling class is selling the dream of upward mobility to all citizens, regardless of their situation or upbringing. In the United States, you may be familiar with the American Dream rhetoric.
I'm looking for a few good men and women who aren't afraid of hard work, aren't afraid to roll up their sleeves.
Cliche, I know, but
I'm looking for scrap hustlers, guys who are willing to roll up their sleeves.
People with a little drive, they got a little fire in them.
Got a little chutzpah. I stand right here before you today, and I'm going to offer you something as precious as gold. You know what that is?
Anybody?
Opportunity.
It's opportunity.
Opportunity to advance,
to move forward,
to move on,
to advance, to succeed, to win,
to step up.
The sky's the limit. Grab the brass ring.
To give yourself a shot at the American dream.
Put your arms around the American dream.
Opportunity.
Because I'll tell you something,
at McDonald's,
just like this great nation of ours,
some of that elbow grease,
guarantee you,
if you've got the guts,
you've got the gumption,
you've got the desire,
I guarantee you, you can succeed.
There's gold to be had at the end of
those golden arches.
Golden arches. Now, who's with me? Who wants to jump on that ladder to success?
Become part of the McDonald's Spucha.
Now, who's with me?
The ruling class consistently echoes the common talking point that if you dedicate yourself to education, training, risk-taking, and hard work, then you too can attain the American dream.
America has made a remarkable economic recovery. Some even call it a miracle. But as the recovery has gathered steam, inequity in the U.S. has worsened. Millions of workers have slipped into low-paid, part-time jobs, swelling the ranks of the working poor, while the American middle class steadily withers.
There's a chart I saw recently that I can't get out of my head. A Harvard business professor and economist asked more than 5,000 Americans how they thought wealth was distributed in the United States. This is what they said they thought it was. Dividing the country into five rough groups of the top, bottom, and middle three 20% groups, they asked people how they thought the wealth in this country was divided. Then he asked them what they thought was the ideal distribution. And 92%, that's at least 9 out of 10 of them, said it should be more like this. In other words, more equitable than they think it is. Now that fact is telling, admittedly, the notion that most Americans know that the system is already skewed unfairly. But what's most interesting to me is the reality compared to our perception. The ideal is as far removed from our perception of reality as the actual distribution is from what we think exists in this country. So ignore the ideal for a moment. Here's what we think it is again. And here is the actual distribution. Shockingly skewed. Not only do the bottom 20% and the next 20%, the bottom 40% of Americans barely have any of the wealth. I mean, it's hard to even see them on the chart. But the top 1% has more of the country's wealth than 9 out of 10 Americans believe the entire top 20% should have. Mind-blowing. But let's look at it another way, because I find this chart kind of difficult to wrap my head around.
So it's actually 9 pieces of pie.
Wow.
Yeah. 90% of the wealth is right here in the top.
That's terrible.
Now, the upper middle class and the middle class, they share one piece. So these guys, they've got about 80% of a piece. They get 20% of a piece. And then the lower middle class, they've got 0.3% of a piece. Yeah, they have some crumbs there. There you go. That's what they get. And the poorest, they have no pie. In fact, they have less than no pie. They actually have a bill for pie. They're in pie debt. They owe pie.
People in the poorest 20% are, on average, more than $6,000 in debt.
It's very sad.
Yeah?
It's very sad. It's very depressing. I grew up here.
Really?
When we say the American dream, you can define that a lot of different ways. But I think core to that is the idea that this country is a land of opportunity where anybody who works hard and plays by the rules can achieve a baseline of material security for themselves and a better life for their children, while those who go the extra mile and develop special skills or are born with special gifts will be able to rise in society no matter where they're born and you know make great contributions to our country. And this is called the American dream and not the American reality for a reason. We've never fully achieved that.
Ascribing to these hegemonic ideologies produces a sense of false consciousness. You need not look farther than your own social circle to realize that it often takes more than sacrifice, risk-taking, and hard work to be successful in a hegemonic society. How many hard-working individuals do you know of that have multiple degrees and take risk, yet live paycheck to paycheck? I would guess that everyone can think of someone who meets this description. Nonetheless, blindly believing what the elitist is peddling is one form of false consciousness. Subalternity. The Gramscian concept of subalternity applies to those individuals, groups, or entities in society who lack autonomous power. The term subalternity refers to a condition of subordination brought about by economic, social, racial, linguistic, and cultural dominance.
My lord, blacks are not unaware of the hardships they endure or what the government is doing to them. We want them to stop accepting these hardships, to confront them. People must not just give in to the hardships of life. They must find a way, even in this environment, to develop hope. Hope for themselves, hope for this country. Now I think that is what black consciousness is all about. Now without any reference to the white man, to try and build up a sense of our own humanity, our legitimate place in the world.
Power. According to Marx, power is held in society by the dominant class at the expense of the subordinate class. The subordinate class possesses only the strength of labor and time to work and make a living.
Look, either you go in there right now, or we'll find someone who will. And you can go clean out your locker.
Come on, man.
No. That's the deal, okay? In you go.
Controlling people's beliefs and ideas is key to attaining and maintaining power.
Good evening.
For too long, we in Washington have been lying to you. We say we're here to serve you, when in fact, we're serving ourselves. And why? We are driven by our own desire to get reelected. Our need to stay in power eclipses our duty to govern. That ends tonight. Tonight, I give you the truth. And the truth is this. The American dream has failed you. Work hard, play by the rules. You aren't guaranteed success. Your children will not have a better life than you did. 10 million of you can't even get a job, even though you desperately want one.
All fellow members of the Roman Senate, hear me. Shall we continue to build palace after palace for the rich? Or shall we aspire to a more noble purpose and build decent housing for the poor? How does the Senate vote?
Fund the poor!
Good.
Control. Hegemonic control refers to when the ruling class controls the working class by making them accept their ideology. People do not control ideas. Ideas control people.
Seneca, why do you think we have a winner?
What do you mean?
I mean, why do we have a winner? I mean, if we just wanted to intimidate the districts, why not round up 24 of them at random and execute them all at once? Be a lot faster. Hope.
Hope?
Hope. It is the only thing stronger than fear. A little hope is effective. A lot of hope is dangerous. A spark is fine, as long as it's contained.
So,
contain it.
Here are some examples of false consciousness. The working class obeying social leaders in the belief that these leaders represent God.
Angelus are under close scrutiny this morning. It comes as Pastor Creflo Dollar asks his followers to buy him a $65 million private jet.
The resurrection.
Dollar owns this multi-million dollar mansion and condo. In March, his website asked the faithful to help him buy something else.
To give contributions of $300 US or more.
A $65 million Gulfstream G650 jet, the top of the line in luxury air travel.
What's Pastor Dollar's prosperity gospel really all about?
What is it all about? It's about feeding him. It's about him eating. I'm going to tell you whatever I need to tell you to get you to put money in my pocket.
One church member, Mary Jones, plans on answering the pastor's call, even though she rides the bus 20 miles every Sunday to Dollar's church.
We support our pastor. That's what we're here for. The work that he do and where the Lord have him traveling, he doesn't need a cheap airplane. He needs the best.
False consciousness. The inability to recognize or admit that social injustices exist, or convincing oneself that the oppression of a particular group does not occur.
Yeah, I don't think of Boston as a racist city at all.
So how do you know?
I don't feel it. You know, it's just a gut feel. I don't feel like it's racist. I've just never encountered it.
Huh. False consciousness. Participating in one's own oppression.
Can a woman be president?
The presidency is a man's job.
I have women are qualified to be president.
No. A female has more hormones. She could start a war in 10 seconds. If she has hot flashes, whatever, boom.
Haven't all wars been started by men?
Yes. Whenever I hear president, I think of man. It's a man's job. What sort of, I may be...
Close-minded.
No, yeah, well, no.
Misogynistic?
No.
You're voting against your own interests.
That's it. Thank you very much.
False consciousness.
Reagan flooded the community with drugs. That's a terrible thing. But then we asked the Democrats to do something about it.
What did they do?
They locked up everybody who sold drugs and left the crackheads to raise the community. Thank you, Democrats. And this is the funny part. the person who wrote the bill for all of the locking up is the nigga you asking us to vote for now. Which is hilarious that you say the Republicans didn't do anything, when in fact, as terrible as Donald Trump is, he made it so that all of those people who were locked up were able to vote again, giving us voting power again. All those people who had felonies that could not vote can now vote again, and they voted for the nigga who put them in prison. Good job, black community. Way to stick together.
False consciousness.
We're in the state of Mississippi. I don't care for the government. They don't show me anything.
You get food stamps.
Yeah, but I think I deserve food stamps. I have no unemployment.
I hate Obamacare. I think it's retarded and pointless.
But a lot of people in Mississippi need health care.
Yeah.
That's
right.
Voting Republican hasn't worked for you.
But it could.
But it hasn't.
It hasn't, but it could.
Why is the poorest state the most conservative state?
We would rather go broke and die hungry than to give up our moral beliefs.
False consciousness. The working class accepting the words of public figures as factual.
Tucker Carlson likes to brand himself as a real man of the people.
Politicians, big business, the media, they are all on the same side.
Taking on the liberal elite.
Now Democrats have become the party of the elite professional class.
And standing up for everyday Americans.
It's not a left-right thing, it's a ruling class versus everybody else thing.
He wrote a whole book about how America's selfish ruling class is bringing the country to the brink of revolution.
Division helps them maintain their power, even as it destroys our country.
The Atlantic even called him the bow-tied bard of populist.
The actual problem is the corrupt and decadent leadership of our own elites. The elites. Liberal elites. It is sickening, and we've had enough of it.
There's just one problem with Tucker's man of the people shtick.
You're about the most unordinary person I know. You're an elitist. You're an asshole.
No. I'm an out-of-the-closet elitist. I don't run around pretending to be a man of the people. I'm absolutely not a man of the people at all.
Yeah.
False consciousness. Voting in such a way that benefits the members of the ruling class instead of those in the working class.
We at the Birmingham team have a great leadership. We really don't need anyone coming in and telling us what they want to give us, because basically we have everything we need here. Always want it to work for Amazon. This is the only place I've seen that have benefits from day one. There's no waiting period. You got chances to advance.
Vote no for the union.
I will vote no.
It's not needed.
Vote no, we can do it without the dues.
False consciousness. False consciousness exists because the working class vastly outnumbers the ruling class. Therefore, it is necessary for the ruling class to consistently produce false consciousness to maintain control. The ruling hegemonic class produces false consciousness to keep the working class passive, cooperative, and conservative. Additionally, the cultural hegemony of the dominant class prevents the working class from realizing their true interests or from developing a value system that would provide the ideological infrastructure for revolutionary change.
You're so concerned with squabbling for the scraps from Longshank's table that you've missed your God-given right to something better. There's a difference between us. You think the people of this country exist to provide you with position. I think your position exists to provide those people with freedom. And I go to make sure that they have it.
Given the demagoguery emanating from our current government and the explicit exploitation of racism and xenophobia to persuade poor and working class white populations that their interests called for an attack on racialized communities, it is important to point out that the suffering of poor white and working class communities has been caused pretty much by the same economic phenomena that are responsible for the rise of mass incarceration and the prison industrial complex, and for the reasons that lead people from Central America, Mexico, elsewhere in the global South to migrate to other countries. As a result of the assault on the labor movement, and as a result of the continuing massive transfer of wealth to the already wealthy, we know that 8 billionaires own as much as the poorest half of humanity. Today, it has been calculated that there are approximately 7.6 billion people in the world, half of which would amount to 3.8 billion. Now, 8 people, including Mark Zuckerberg, Bill Gates, Jeff Bezos, and we could continue, Warren Buffett, Michael Bloomberg, and others, they own more than 3.8 billion people combined. Isn't that obscene? Why then can people be led so easily to believe that they are poor because immigrants cross the border from Mexico? The figure of the immigrant is an ideologically constructed scapegoat designed to deter poor and working class people in the U.S. from recognizing how much they have in common with people who are fleeing difficult economic circumstances, often created by the very corporations that have left people in the U.S. bereft of employment.
I want to reach 1 million likes, so please sarapakara. Okay, thank you.